Yes. Tucked in the... Oh, that's a big one!
Hey guys, Jimmy here, and welcome back to another video. Now, Goodwood Festival of Speed, one of my favourite motoring events on the calendar, was cancelled this year due to Daddy Rona. So I thought what the world needed is a very scruffy looking shed man putting on his own extreme budget Goodwood Festival of Speed. But with one catch, every car is an F1 car because speed. If you haven't heard of the Goodwood Festival of Speed, get out. Actually, please don't. I want the view. Please. Please stay. But basically, the main draw of the event is the hill climb, which sees a wide array of different race cars from all different time periods yeeting up the hill climb as quick as possible. So that's what we're going to be doing today. And just before we get started, if you do end up enjoying the video, I'd very much appreciate you tapping the like button, subscribing. I'm trying to go for that 600k before the end of the year. Looking a bit unlikely, but man's got to have goals. So the first up the hill today is a car that isn't strictly a Formula One car, but it did take part in the 1923 French Grand Prix, and that's enough for me. This is the Bugatti Type 23, and I think it's fair to say that it's a cutie. Look at it. Look how cute it is. You can see by the body of the car that Bugatti were actually experimenting with some sort of early aero. Very slippery in a straight line, this, but it does have drum brakes all round, about 100 horsepower or so, rear-wheel drive, and three gears. Not the 8 we're used to today. So I don't really expect a record breaking time for this car, but I reckon it'll be a ton of fun, which is the entire point of this event. Right then, so virginity gloves going on to protect myself from the gilf. That is the Bugatti Type 32. You can check out the link for these in the description, by the way. Very smooth shill. Anyway, first car up the hill. Let's go! Bit of wheel spin there as we get away. 100 horsepower at our disposal. Second gear, up towards 80k's. 100k's, remember, of course, is about 60 miles an hour. Tap the brakes on the way through. The brakes on this is abysmal. They really are. That in twin with the bicycle tyres means that we don't really have much cornering potential here at all. But what do you expect? The car's nearly 100 years old, which is absolutely mad. So, got to try and time our braking now down towards the hay bales at the bottom of the hill here. Very easy to get that wrong. So, we're going to brake just at the crest, down the second gear, heel and toe. Try and carry as much speed as possible. Understeer and oversteer at the same time, like a four-wheel understeer there. Now up towards the wall. One of the quickest part of the circus. We'll hold second gear for now. Dab of the brakes on the way in. Be careful on the right here. The bale's coming quickly. I'm being quite conservative for this car because it is an old boy. Easy. There you go, nice. And now we can keep it pinned all the way to the top of the hill climb. I'm not quite sure what time to expect, probably in the 110s somewhere. Up to third gear. Keep it pinned to the line, and our lap time first up the hill is a 112.1. So, not bad for a car that is 97 years old. But we're going to go a bit newer now, and with a significantly bigger engine. Now, we skip forward now, 14 years. It's kind of crazy to think this is a progression made in that time. To this, the Auto Union Type C. Now, if you can count to 10, like me, you'll see that we have 8 exhaust tips there on this side of the car. And guess what? 8 on the other side as well, which means we have a V16 engine behind us, producing about 530 brake horsepower, which should mean we get to the top a little bit quicker than that Type 32. Time to go up the hill then, and this car I have driven before, it is brutal. It will spin the wheels in pretty much any gear. And again, whilst technically not being a Formula One car, I did take part in a couple of Grand Prix. But hey, any excuse to drive this thing. Revs up. Let's go. Try and keep it as straight as possible here on these big old bicycle tyres. Already to 60 very, very quickly in this thing. And I'm just on the brake straight away because this thing's braking distance is humongous. It is large. It is thick. Not in the good ways, though. Just on the grass there, trying to get on the throttle. There's 100 mile an hour, up to third gear, nearly 200k's. I'm going to brake early, I'm going to brake very early, down the second gear, holding the brake all the way in there, just not really confident at all with pushing this thing, trying to get on the throttle, but just spits you out straight away. Hold second gear up towards the wall, again, heavy on the brakes, very heavy on the brakes, drums all around, just like the other car. Oh my god. I can see why people don't drive this thing up here, it is beastly. Sometimes this car has four tyres on the rear as opposed to the two it has now. Up the top of the hill, being easy. Now we unleash it, now we go. Oh, 101.7 sideways over the line. This thing has more power than sense, which means it's a fantastic race car, of course. 10 seconds faster than the Bugatti. Not quite surprised by that, but now we're going to go to some cars maybe you'll recognise a bit more, but gotta love these pre-war cars. Next up is a car you probably recognise, and again, we're jumping forward in time quite a bit, to 1967. This is the Lotus 49, as made famous, of course, by Jim Clark and Graham Hill, and is important for a number of reasons. Firstly, it's being one of the more successful cars of the time, despite some reliability issues, and also having the gearbox for the first time as a structural part of the car, not being individual. Powered by a DFV V8 Cosworth engine, about 400 plus horsepower or so. Chonky tyres, better brakes, some disc brakes for crying out loud, so this thing should be annihilating the Auto Union Type C, if I can keep it together. Something else to point out, compared to the Type C, this car is a hell of a lot lighter. We're talking about 400, 500 kilos in terms of weight for this thing. It's effectively a kayak filled with race fuel. Very safe, but very fast. Let's go. Right, up to second gear, just smashing by nearly 100 mile an hour down to the first corner here. I'm being nice and cautious. This thing, of course, likes to oversteer big time on the throttle, as you can imagine, from something this light and this powerful. All right, try and keep it straight. Up to fourth gear, very short gearing, of course, to the hill climb course, and then we're going to get on the brakes. Probably do it a bit later than that, but I'm being a bit cautious to make sure we get round. Open wrap again, towards the wall, charging towards it. Hold third gear, tap the brakes, locking up on the way in, sliding through, working the wheel big time. Again, same for this right-hander, watch out for the bales, nice. Up to fourth gear, easy over the rise, and into the line, 220Ks at the line, and a 48.5. Another 14 seconds faster. What a car, gotta love this Lotus 49. I could probably go a bit quicker if I was being a bit more aggressive, but sort of risk versus reward in this thing, but awesome car this. But now we start getting into downforce. I like downforce. That's right, fat old rear tires and massive airbox. It can only be a 70s F1 car. This is the Ferrari 312T, as driven by Niki Lauda to the 1975 F1 World Championship, and was also the car to finally end the domination of that DFV V8 we talked about before. This thing had a V12 engine, about 500 horsepower or so, so not a lot more than the Lotus 49, but those slicks and this aero is going to make a massive difference on the time up the hill. V12 time, baby! Can't moan about it. All the noise. Right. V12T away. A good one. Second gear already up to 100 mile an hour before T1 there. Tires a bit cold, having to be, a bit cold is an understatement, Christ. This won't keep it together there for that first section. Up to fourth gear, we can brake quite late in this car. We've got aero on our side and tyre grip, a lot later than the 49 anyway. Now we get to hurtle towards the wall, got to be brave through here. Trust the aero is going to work, it does kind of work. There you go, so I told you kind of, a little bit of a bad line into there. Brake quite heavily into here, heavier than you think, because that hay bale comes up on the left. And now we just run it out to the line at the V12, sing up the hill. Across the line, and a 45.5, 3 seconds quicker than the 49. Of course, those times are going to get closer and closer as we get faster and faster. It takes more effort to get that speed, but enjoying the start of the aero. Could have been quicker at the bottom, definitely, but I like to try and do these laps in one hit, as I sort of would in real life. 45.5, not bad. So now we start to get serious in terms of power. This is the Lotus 98T from the mid-80s, as made famous by Johnny Dumfries and a little-known Brazilian driver by the name of Ayrton Senna. In qualifying trim, which is what we are running today, this thing produces around 1,200 horsepower from a turbocharged V6 engine. And we've also bolted on some qualifying slicks, which in real life were good for about a lap and a half before they just disintegrated. Hopefully, they'll get us up the hill climb. Just pulling away in this thing is going to be a challenge because of all the power, but we'll give it our best shot. 98T, a good wood. Oh my God, already up to third gear, nearly 200K through there. Come on, be brave, Jimmy. We've got a lot of aero, a lot of grip on the tyres. Now unleash it. Such short gearing. Oh my god. I've slowed down nice and early there just to make sure I get into the corner. The boost, wheel spinning in third gear. Up to the wall, past it like it's nothing. Oh, just touching the hay bales. Now we just rag it out to the line. And it's a 39.5. I'm not sure that compares to my last time up here in this car, but I don't care. First run, and we go sub 40. Whew. Cars are getting quick now. Imagine driving that around a street circuit. Whew. Tell me those guys didn't have extreme testicular fortitude, I dare you. Next up, the Ferrari 642. V12 goodness, ladies and gentlemen. If you like F1, if you like early 90s F1, you'll know all about the V12 Ferraris and their distinctive V12 RE. 700 horsepower or so, again going for a very sticky compound of tyre as well, and lots of aero. Hopefully, we can challenge the beast that is a 98T, but we'll see. Now, I've got a feeling this is going to be quick. Quali tyres, V12 behind us, and the shortest gearing I think I can get in this car. Let's see how this 642 does. That is a good noise. Nearly into the bales at the start, but already up to fourth gear before we get towards the first corner. Lots of understeer through there. I'm going to chuck the car in a bit too quick. Just onto the grass for a second, and then up to seventh gear, 260, 270 kilometers an hour. Hammer the brakes. Use the air and slow the car down. Revs rise, so we hit the bumps, then we have to attack this wall. Down a gear, in. Fantastic. Down a gear through here as well. Just trying to get the car turned in. Very nice. And now, run it to the line. Let the V12 run away. Let's see them gear 270 across the line. 35.5. Even the 98T can keep out of that. What a noise. There aren't many cars that are more pleasurable to drive than the V12 Ferrari. I can tell you that now, but we're starting to get very, very quick as we get newer and newer. So next up is the car that actually held the record for Goodwood Hill Climb for a very, very long time. This is the McLaren MP413, the car that took Mika Häkkinen to his 1998 F1 World Championship, although this one is the DC version, with a real-life car doing a 41.6. We've beaten that a couple of times today, but we haven't got to fear that pesky thing called death when we do our runs. And whilst this thing does have more power than the Ferrari we just drove, with nearly 800 horsepower being produced by that Mercedes-Benz V10 sitting in the back there, it is about 100 kilograms heavier, narrower, and also has grooved slick tires. That's probably going to slow us down quite a bit compared to the Ferrari. This thing sounds great, so I don't care. So McLaren Mercedes V10. That guy over there loves it. Let's see what we can do. Warm those grooved tires up, shall we? Go, go, go! Oh. She's a bit aggressive. There's zero grip on these tyres. There you go, now we're away. Pick a braking spot, we'll try that. Easy. Car's trying to lock up everywhere. It's so nervous, this car, compared to the Ferrari we just drove. Can we attack the wall in the same way? No chance. It's trying to spin it every time I turn it in. Easy. Now we're onto the line. Can that Mercedes-Benz engine make up for lost time? No, it can't. It's going to be a 38.4. Those qualifying tyres in the Ferrari really proving the difference. Even with this soft compound groove tyre, just couldn't get the power down. Scrambling for grip all the way up the hill. But we were faster than Nick Heidfeld in real life. So there you go, guys. I'm a better driver than Nick Heidfeld. Don't take that seriously for crying out loud. And now we go to one of the most recognisable Formula One cars of all time. This is the Ferrari F2004, as driven by Michael Schumacher for the 2004 F1 World title. Nearly 900 horsepower from the V10 engine in the back, of course, still on the groove compound of tyres, but much quicker than the late 90s McLaren, I can tell you that now. And we also have things like traction control at our disposal as well. So hopefully, this should be a little bit less eventful than our run-up in the McLaren, but should be a bit quicker. Man, I love this car. Let's see what we can do with it. Air traction control. Oh, that short gearing is lovely. Oh, so much more grip than the McLaren. Don't worry about it. There, seventh gear. 280k, smash the brakes. Turn it in. Oh, it just sticks. It just sticks. It's almost like it's on slick tyres. As opposed to these groove ones. Downshift through here. There you go. Now we can run to the line. Ferrari V10 winning us up the hill. And it's a 34.3. We go quicker. And the V12 Ferrari. Not by much, though, but it's getting harder and harder to improve now as we get newer and newer. Any excuse to drive this car, man. Any excuse. Keep fighting, Michael, man. Keep fighting. So a fairly short leap in time to our next car. This is the Ferrari F2007. So 3 years further on from the car we just drove. And this is a championship-winning car for Kimi Raikkonen. He won his first and only championship in F1 in 2007. Of course, V8 engine in this thing compared to the V10 that was in the last car. Aero has moved on somewhat from 2004, but they just seem to lack the pace of the 2004 car. So I don't really expect this to be quicker. But I was curious to see how it would do. Right, hunkered down in the cockpit then in our F2007. Let's see how we do. Let's go. Oh. Crash control. Coming in there. Turn her in. Not quite carrying the speed I want to through there, but it's okay. Let's pick up a little bit of grass on exit. That V8 still projecting us to well over 280k there as we come down to the braking zone. Again, to the wall now. Got a lot of air at our disposal, so we can really throw her in. Little break up the top here. And now to the line. Not a bad run. Thing is gripping like nothing else. 34.7. I think that is just marginally slower than the V10. I've got to actually double check that very quickly. Give me 2 seconds. Yes, just under 4 tenths slower than the 2004 car. Not a bad effort though from the F2007, and actually quite a nice car to drive this. The guys at VRC, you really knocked this out of the park. Go give it a try if you haven't done so already. And now for our second to last car to take on the hill climb. This is the Williams FW37, the 2015 Formula One car driven by Felipe Massa. And of course, Valtteri Bottas. And I picked this car to represent this set of regs where the cars are all horrible and high and tall and not very nice to look at. So V6 hybrid era, of course, this car, about 700 horsepower from that ICE V6, with another 100, 110 or so being added by the ERS. I reckon this run will be a little bit leery, but I don't know how quick it's going to be compared to the cars from before. These cars are actually quite slow compared to the mid-2000s cars. Now, to give us the best chance possible, I have turned the ERS all the way up, turned the recovery all the way down, and we even have a bit of DRS down towards T1. So hopefully, that'll put us somewhere near the Ferraris. Let's build those revs up. And then bog off the line. Clutch kick, baby! DRS open, let's go! Heavy brake in the T1, not quite sure what this car's going to do. Oh god, it's sensitive at the rear. Can't just nail the throttle in this car like you can in the others. DRS open again. Oh my god, it's wrapping the straight line. There's only 300k's! It's fast in a straight line, not in the corners though. DRS open again. Gonna close it for the wall. It's not quite carrying that same cornering speed in this car. DRS open once more. Close it for this little corner. Back open again. Across the line. It's a 35.8. We're quite a bit slower than the old F1 cars. But in a straight line, this thing... ridiculous of a DRS, and the ERS turned up. Nearly 20 mile an hour we hit on that run. Mad. But that's our second to last car. Now we're gonna see what a modern Formula One car can do up here. I'm looking forward to this. And now last but certainly not least, the 2020 F1 car, or the Formula Hybrid 2020 by Racing Studio, if you want to be particular. Let's talk numbers, because I think people sometimes forget just how fast this car is and just how far it's come in terms of advancements. So let me talk a couple of numbers for you. We have 1,000 horsepower from the engine alone. Then we have ERS on top of that, DRS2, some of the most advanced aero we've ever seen in Formula One, and these chunky slick tyres as well as DRS. This thing should destroy everything that's gone before it. If it hasn't, that's down to me. So let's cap off this video with a feckin' quick time. So I've taken all the fuel out, but with all the aero on, we have the softest compound of tar as well, and DRS already open and waiting. Let's see what a modern F1 car can do up Goodwood. Ah, yes, you love to see it. Oh, and the grip is just substantial. Bit of a lift through there. DRS open again. So much speed down to the bottom here. So late on the brakes, and you can just turn it in, and it just turns. It just sticks. Now we've got to be brave through here to get the most out of it. Oh my god, that can almost be flat, I think. Over the crest of the hill. Bit of a bump there. Turns down a little bit. Doesn't matter though. Over the line, and it's a 32.9, smashing everything else out of the water as expected. Dipping into sub 33 territory, extremely impressive. And I think these cars just don't get enough love, I think because of the Mercedes domination. When these cars go, you will miss them. And here on screen are the final standings. So that was a ton of fun. I really hope you enjoyed watching as much as I enjoyed making it, because any excuse to drive F1 cars fast anywhere is a good one. And if you did enjoy the video, I'd very much appreciate you tapping the like button, subscribing, hitting that bell icon, all the good stuff. And let me know in the comments below what cars you want to see go up here next. A big thank you to my long-suffering friend Bailey for doing all the graphics for us. They look absolutely fantastic. And another thank you to all those people who have hit the join button down below or support me on Patreon. It is very much appreciated. Take care. Have an awesome day. I'll see you all next time.